Hi, I'm Elyse. I live in Northeast Florida. I'm here to talk today about my permaculture experiments. We've been doing this for about 4 years. A little bit of history about me. I grew up in the 60s in Florida. My mom was an eco-warrior from the very beginning. We grew organic roses back when organic wasn't really even a term. So I moved to Ohio and everything grew fantastically for me. We renovated houses, and one of the things we would do to make a little money is I would take the kids in the stroller and go and work on people's gardens, and it was great. So then I came back to Northeast Florida and I ended up on a giant sand hill, and I've never had such a terrible time trying to grow things. I tried all the techniques I had used before. The method called Back to Eden was one of the ones we used since the 60s. You know, he's incorporated the name of the method, but it's an old method. I tried container garden, raised gardening. I tried self-watering containers. Nothing seemed to work, and I pretty much was giving up. And then I encountered permaculture, which ironically I had heard about in Ohio, but didn't need back then. So I started using permaculture. I started with my raised beds. I promptly took them out because I realized how unnecessary they were, that permaculture really worked. The technique that I use is sort of a combination of the concept of Hügels, which is a German word, and also the concept that Ruth Stout put forth back in the 20s. You can find her on YouTube. She was in her 80s when she died, called lasagna gardening. So what I do here, instead of the standard Hügel pit gardening or lasagna gardening, instead of 2 feet deep, I do 4 feet down. I've marked my shovel so I know when to stop. And then I do 2 feet wide. And what I've found when I do it, to only do 4 feet at a time so I can finish it. The reason why I suggest finishing it, Florida's soil is so fragile that when you expose it to the sun, it actually kills a lot of the beneficial flora and fauna that you need in your garden. So you need to keep it covered. So the 4 feet long by 4 feet deep by 4 feet wide has been my best method. If I can't finish it, I cover everything with tarp. So then, now that I have this trench built, I put in it new logs, and in Florida it's easy to find debris everywhere, and then I do old logs, and then I start filling in a little bit of dirt at a time, and in each layer I start putting in sticks. I do manure, and you want to look up your ratios on that. It's 80% brown to 20% green, but some natural manures turn brown from green, so you'll need to look into that. And then as many different kinds of manures as you can get. I have access to alpaca, goat, chicken, and rabbit. So then I layer that in. I keep throwing in the old dirt, keep throwing it in, keep layering. And I end up with a mound about a foot high. And that's what you see here. The reason why it looks flat is in between I use all the wood chips. And in Florida, we tend to have pine, which is allelopathic. Allelopathic means it stops germination of plants. So you don't want to put your wood chips in your garden. That was one of my mistakes I made when I followed the Back to the Eden idea. So I use those as pathways. What I'll do is do 2 layers of cardboard. I'm lucky to get free cardboard. And then I'll put in the wood chips as high as the Hügel, so it almost looks flat. Next year, if this is turned to soil, sometimes it takes 2 years, the pathway, I will throw that new soil onto the Hügel for my next year. So the idea of permaculture comes into play. First, you build your structures, build your gardens, and then from that point on, it's just maintenance. And that for me is perfect. I am an older person by myself as far as the garden is concerned. My husband is my patron of the arts, and he helps support my hobby, but this is definitely my baby, so it has to be easy for me. So next year I'll be able to take a shovel and do top layers and toss it. It's what I did this year from last year's, and I get these fantastic gardens. After I build my Hügel, you can plant directly into it. I always encourage nitrogen fixing plants. In the winter, Austrian winter peas is my favorite. In the summer, you can do beans, peas, anything that will fix nitrogen to the soil. And then you can plant directly. Whenever you need space for some kind of vegetable or tree, you just move it aside. You can bury it. It can be part of the green matter that's now your hay. And it increases the nitrogen capacity of the soil besides the nitrogen fixing. I joke about my life's motto is the old Chinese proverb, give your laziest man the most complicated task. I try to make things simple. So what I've done is gone to the feed store and I've gotten this wonderful planting calendar, and it's organized by winter, spring, summer, and fall. So I cut off each category. I did it kind of like scrapbooking where it had its own page. And then I figured out the rows. In organic gardening, you do crop rotation to cut the cycle of insects. It's a benign way of disrupting them so that you find their weakest part of their cycle, which is usually their larvae, and you disturb the area so they can't produce as many offspring, so you don't have as many issues, you don't have to spray, you don't have to do all the things that modern farming uses. So using the crop rotation idea with these, I figured out, I went ahead and blew it up between the normal four categories of a crop rotation. I blew it up to 10 categories just because I wanted a variety of vegetables. So I assigned rows, and because I'm simple and it's easy, I went ahead and made permanent physical structures that I can use as trellises or as design, because I also like to incorporate art into my garden. So what you're seeing here is a representation of 10 rows. A lot of the rows go this way, and they're purposely curved because I use a tool called an A-level that helps me find how water flows on my property. It's another way of trapping water so I don't have to water my garden. And then when I plant my plants, I also apply the lazy man principle. Now that I've figured out my rows, say for instance tomatoes and peppers can go together, I get jars and I mark on them row 1, 2, 3, and 4 all the way up to 10, and I just pour the seeds in each jar so they're all mixed in, and then I figure out the companion plants that will work with them. And you do have to do some research on that, because I found that dill, if it's applied at certain levels, will actually stop germination of some plants. So make sure your companion plant really does work with whatever row you're doing. So I throw all the seeds together, and then again using the lazy man principle, I take the jar and I gently go along and I sprinkle, and then I cover over the dirt. Yes, I'm not measuring the distance between each plant, I'm not measuring the height, so there's a little bit of a natural approach, if you will. And then I cover that row. And so I know now ahead of time that next year I'm not going to plant in that row, because I'll shift all the rows. So already I've cut the offspring, the larvae of the bugs coming on. I have the companion plants in there, which will also aim at that approach. Companion plants are also designed to bring in beneficial bugs. What you'll find, what a lot of people, when they run to the store to get chemicals, is because they're trying to fix something that is a huge problem. They have all these bad bugs. Oh my gosh, I gotta get rid of them. If they would just wait, the good bugs will come, because hey, there's now a buffet. So the key is to wait in permaculture and in organic gardening. Wait, sit back. Yes, you may lose your tomatoes this year, but next year it's going to be more balanced, because you're going to have the eggs from the good bugs too. So this is kind of one more approach to that. It's about patience. It's about using this technique over a year's period, not just 1 year, where everything works together better. I really like to step out of the standard American vegetables. They're actually European vegetables, because they do require a lot of little extra special care, and I'm always looking for things that are going to be, first of all, perennial, and then second of all, that my family will eat. So I look across the globe at areas that have the exact same temperature and climate. A good example is Southeast Asia, the Philippine area, Texas is another, and I look for varieties that the natives enjoy. If you can find out the name for grandma in that culture and then go to YouTube and put in how my grandma makes it using their word, then you can oftentimes get fantastic recipes. An example is Roselle. Well, one of the things I've been talking about is the annual approach. One of my goals is incorporating in all the old organic techniques that I know in with permaculture, so it works for a family. So the other portion of permaculture as far as gardening is the food forest concept, or the perennials. So what I've done also with these trellises is to help protect from my enthusiastic digging and poor memory, where I've put in trees or things that I want to have as a long term. When you dig up your perennials, you're disturbing roots. You want to make sure you don't disturb the roots of your nut trees or that type of thing. Eventually they end up being very weak as far as holding onto the ground, and they'll collapse on you. So I have the trees designed in specific areas so that they are protected. I know, hey, wait a minute, this is a tree don't dig X amount of distance around it, I'm fortunate to have a lot of space to work in. This system that I use can be adapted down back to the four rotations for a much smaller space, and you can still incorporate perennial ideas. What I have going on here, and it all looks like twigs because of this time of year, is I have persimmon, I have three kinds. I have three types of olives we can grow in North Florida. I have something called basswood or linden tree, which is all edible. I have an ever-bearing mulberry, and that is specifically designed to trick birds from staying away from my vegetables. You want to pick things as far as the companion idea that the birds would rather have the fruit of that tree than your tomato. So this is kind of some of the ideas of companion planting. I have strawberry guava, I have pecan, I use redbud. Redbud has an edible flower. It's one of my favorite plants because of the heart-shaped leaf, but it also is a tree that fixes nitrogen. I've actually densely planted the redbud with the idea that I will be eliminating some of them in the future. The other thing that we use here is called moringa. Moringa is a nitrogen producer, but it is a fantastic chop and drop. There's some little phrases in permaculture that you use. Chop and drop simply refers to the fact that, hey, it's time to fertilize this plant. I'm going to walk over to my moringa, cut it, throw it down. Now it's going to create more nitrogen in that specific area. Going back to the idea of permanence in permaculture, remember I talked about how you put the beds in, and then from that point on, the maintenance is very low. That should be part of your maintenance in the future. That's the easy part, the chop and drop, the shifting the topsoil onto your hugels, that kind of thing. One of the things I found in permaculture was a gap between urban settings, small gardens, and the very large farms that Jeff Lawson and Mark Shepherd do. I wanted to find a spot in there for a smaller, more hobbyist type farmer, somebody who has a little bit of property where they can maybe do a backyard garden, but also want to incorporate in the food forest idea and the perennials. One of my favorite plants that I've brought into my garden, which is a perennial, is called chaya. And it is something the deer do not like to eat. It's toxic in a raw state, so you do have to cook it. I do canning, so I can a bunch of it. So it's ready to serve, and that's when it is nutritious once you've boiled it. But these, I have about 8 or 9 of these, and they produce like gangbusters. I have spinach all summer long. I don't have to replant them. Again, the idea of permanent culture. One of the other things I like to do is natural or native ground cover. I have Carolina geranium coming on right now. I have stinging nettle, which is fantastic. It tastes wonderful with sauteed with olive oil and Parmesan. Everybody always complains about it this time of year. Another thing that I have is called spiderwort. This I started with one plant, and I probably have 1,000 on the property now. And it is, all of it's edible. It's tough in the center stem like broccoli is, so I just eat the leaves. It produces a beautiful purple flower about 3 times a year. And then I have yarrow. One of the things you do in both your garden and in your permanent food forest is you plant something called a tree guild. The idea is you're putting all the beneficial plants together, the companions that bring bugs, the companions that repel certain bugs. So this is what I've done on a lot of the trees that I've incorporated in here. So you'll see 3 or 4 different types of plants at their base. One of my favorite one to add besides the yarrow is comfrey. I have over here. This is the sterile kind that you have to dig up and break the roots. And then every year I'll go around and put roots at all the bases of all the trees. It's extremely beneficial to the garden, another nitrogen fixing plant. It's also excellent for livestock. I do have livestock here, so a lot of the things I grow also with the intention of feeding them more natural feed. Here's some more of the Carolina geranium. I have, this is the basswood. This is the strawberry guava. I have a pecan I'm trying to start here. I've got it in an area that hopefully it will be able to get as large as it can. It's one of those you have to have cross-pollination, so I have a couple other pecans on the property. This is a daikon radish. I grow in the winter green leafy items, and that's one. That's great spiralized as a noodle substitute. I also grow mustard greens, collards, cabbage, anything that has a leaf structure. This is a Mysore raspberry that's doing fantastically. It's super easy to root and was gifted to me. My intention is to grow it across the whole fencing to help keep the deer out. This is my very first food forest section that I started with as an experiment, period. I always believe in trying things side by side, so I had the raised beds next to it, and the permaculture took off like gangbusters, so I eliminated the raised beds. I have pomegranate, jujube, root beer, asparagus, dwarf mulberry, grape, hummingbird bush, two citruses. From this end of the garden, I'm actually into my row 1 and 2, and these are going to be tomatoes, peppers, all the nightshade plants. You can see a little more clearly the definition and how raised they are from the lower level of the earth. This will all compact as time goes on and become more flat. The purpose for the logs is the mycelium growth. It's really about the interaction of the mycelium, the sugars that they give back to the plants, and actually help create the kind of soil that we're looking for everything to be successful. One of the things that I have to do is incorporate recycling and frugalness. I'm a firm believer in upcycling. I've done it most of my life. This is part of a gazebo from a friend of mine, and to reuse it in such a way that I can use it again, I buy plumbing straps. It comes in a big coil, and then I cut it to size, and I made a little U-shape and used one screw, because again, that my frugalness. And so this one I did attach at the bottom here, but these, can we walk over here? These actually can lift up, and I can take them off quite easily. The point of them, besides marking for me where the rows are and where the food forest plants are, is I can run string when I do peas and beans, run string here, and then take it away so it still looks pleasing aesthetically. Here we have one of my hugels that I have planted for February. And as you can see, I have sprinkled the plants. If you look closely at them, you'll see different kinds, and I will go in and thin them just a little bit to feed my animals. But I'm definitely not into monocropping. You'll see a lot of mixture. The third step for fighting bugs is incorporating these type of structures and the mason bee structures into your garden. This was super simple. I actually found that the green frame in the trash and painted it. And then almost everything there was on the property at the time. And they're super easy and fun to make for the kids. This is a great example on my hugels about the different types of soils that I'm working with. Florida tends to be 0.07% organic compared to 1.0% Iowa. So this is actually more nutritious than I started with. And then as you go into gray, that represents the gray matter. You will see yellow clay, which is the worst in my property too. You can also tell by the plants kind of what's going on. I have a dewberry coming on here, which represents acidic. So within 4 feet, I have a pine, which also represents acidic. So this is all telling me whatever I plant in this section right here may not do as well. This is sugarcane. I love to do trading and bartering, so this was actually something someone gave me, and I will turn around and give some back to him. We can also use it for our animals. If I had pigs right now, they would love the sugarcane in the fall. It grows very well for me here. It is a grass, so it does suck up nutrients, so it's always important to put it in an area where it won't deplete, which goes back to the rotating of the crops idea. I'll put in something that will put nitrogen back in after these are harvested. This is an excellent thing for me to use for privacy also because of the height. They'll get to 8 or 9 feet tall. One of the most costly things in modern farming is fertilizer. There are tons of natural, cheap alternatives. One that I like to use is a barrel, and I put in food, anything that is considered waste. It doesn't end up in our dumps, and it goes back into my soil. I let it ferment, depending on my patience, anywhere from 3 days to several months. I've actually had mealworms grow in it, which gives me feed for my chickens. You can use any plant material. You can use urine as long as it's not medicated. All of it needs to be diluted when you put it on. I bought one of those backpacks that they use at the golf courses, and I filter it very finely, and then I walk around and spot spray whatever I think needs a little bit of extra. We do have a 16-week drought, so sometimes during that time I will water and fertilize depending on the plant. The other thing I like to use is called biochar, and I didn't mention it on the Hugels. When you put it in the Hugel, the closer you go to the top, the less amount you need for biochar. If you do it lower, you'll need a lot more per square inch. There are recipes online on how to make it and how much to put on it. Part of permaculture is care of the people, return to the surplus, and care of the earth. And all of those principles I've been living all along. When I came along permaculture, it was sort of the culmination of all the ideas I've lived my life by. I find the food much more nutritious. There is a way of determining nutrition called the Brix method. They're also developing a second method that I have yet to learn about. Permaculture food is much more nutritious. There's much more of a vitality to it. I often have tons of abundance. My first year of growing permaculture, I had 2 wheelbarrows full of loofah. I find that it also builds community because I'm able to use that as a trading item for extra things. I now have a wonderful network of other people who are like-minded that also have extra abundance of different things, and we're able to trade together. There is one thing about permaculture that you need to know. It is super abundant, and it is a super hard-charging growing system. You have to be ready for the weeds. So my advice is to learn the weeds, figure out what you can eat and what you can do with them, because a lot of them are medicinal, a lot of them are very nutritious, but embrace the weeds and be ready for the ants.